And Margaret joins me now. Margaret, we saw at the State Department, but also at the White House in the briefing room today, very aggressive pushback at the notion that this was a snub, this last-minute decision not to come, especially on the part of the Saudi King. What really happened?
What really happened was, remember, when this was laid on by the White House last month, right after coming up with this political framework for an Iranian nuclear deal. And the hope was that with the right assurances, the Gulf countries would at least give some sort of tacit approval to pursuing this deal. Instead, what the White House thought was a great compliment, being invited to the White House, Camp David, I'm told by people close to the palace in Saudi Arabia that King Salman felt he was being summoned to Washington. He didn't like being lumped in with all the GCC members. Then, because Saudi Arabia should be first among equals, then he, after talking to Secretary Kerry and after the meeting in Paris on Friday, it became obvious he wasn't going to get really the assurances he wanted. And that being from a culture where it's rude to your host to say no, he didn't really want to be taken up to Camp David and then asked to sign something that he'd later want to back off from.
Now, the president did talk to him today to kind of smooth things over,
yes.
We assume.
Yes.
But at the root of this, Iran, right?
At the root of this, Iran, and also the fact that the U.S. and the Saudis, despite all these years of at least some sort of partnership over oil and many other things, really don't know how to, don't understand each other very well. But yes, it's not only that Iran, after 10 or 15 years, whenever the negotiated time period expires, that Iran could be a nuclear weapons capable state. It's the Saudis' fear that once the international community strikes a deal with Iran, Iran will, one, gain in stature and legitimacy, might even supplant the U.S. as a major partner in the region, and that as sanctions are slowly lifted and it has more money, it will be able to even better fund a lot of these groups, proxies that are destabilizing other countries in the region, whether it's Shiite groups in Bahrain, whether it's Hezbollah in Syria, whether it's the Houthis in Yemen.
And, well, let's talk about Yemen a little bit, because I wonder if that is partly also on the agenda for this weekend, or if there's anything else that can be accomplished at this meeting in Camp David.
Well, I think that what the Saudis wanted was, or at least certainly the UAE wanted, was some kind of mutual defense pact, almost like NATO. And the Americans say they've told them weeks ago that was a non-starter. That wasn't going to happen. But the U.S. is talking about not only selling them more weaponry, if that's what they want, but helping the GCC develop greater capabilities to defend against all these unconventional threats, whether it's cyber, whether it's threats to their own oil infrastructure, and make it more interoperable with the U.S. And there will be some sort of document that reaffirms the U.S. commitment to the security of its allies. For instance, when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait, the U.S. was in there. One person close to the Saudi culture who spent a lot of time there said, don't underestimate the human factor here. When this 79-year-old king was confronted with the idea that he had to get on a plane, fly to Washington, get on a helicopter, chopper up to Camp David, sit around in the woods, and then ask to sign on the dotted line, that's not his idea of fun.
It may have been just as simple as that. Margaret Warner, thanks again.
Thank you, Gwen.